And you know, when we first came out here to start the church, we had been 17 years in another church that sent us out here. So we were very knowledgeable and experienced in the Bible, but not ever having been the senior pastors, the buck stops here. So you know, when somebody asks you a tough question, you could call a friend and try to get help. But you take on this heavier responsibility of knowing that they're counting on you to be able to help them. And we knew that, but until you actually are in that role and you see the person that needs an answer to a difficult question, you realize this is a weighty thing that the Lord asks us to do, to be here for each other. And when one rejoices, we all rejoice. And when one is hurting, we are all hurting. And you start to say, Lord, help me to understand and feel what that other person is feeling, until he does that. And you're like, I'm not sure I should have asked for that, because if he really lets you feel the grief that they're feeling, it sobers you again. It's like, oh my Lord, I had no idea the amount of pain that people were in and how good I had it. You know, like often as you get older, you realize your parents weren't so bad after all, right? And that they gave you a home that was safe and the bills were paid and they helped you go to college and they gave you good advice. And boy, every year that goes by, it seems like less and less people have two parents in their home. And how would we know what impact that has if we did have both of our parents, right? So the church is meant to be a reflection of Christ to the society. And they should look at us and say, I don't know what it is about them, but there's something there that I would really like to have. And the reality is that's not always the case, and I can't do much about that, but we can try to operate here in a way as we start this year to say, one of the goals that I would have this year is that 12 months from now, I want to be able to look in the mirror and say, I'm more like Christ now than I was on January 1st when we had that first church service. And this is one of the ways that Isaac Petrie would, you'll see when you, well, if you listen to that teaching that I told you about, talks about that the resurrection power that is talked about in the Bible, yes, speaks of Jesus being resurrected. And it says that the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, what? Abides in you. So that's bringing resurrection power to you, not just when you die, but now. So if you have to lay it down an addiction, it's not just that he doesn't like you and there's not going to be anything on the other side. The idea is we're not trying to fix the addiction. We want to crucify it. Because you can't have a resurrection unless there's first a crucifixion. Crucifixion, yeah, death, crucifixion. Jesus did that for us. So it might be pride, it might be anger, it might be unforgiveness that you're holding on to people. That's not necessarily an addiction, but it's a trait that you know is keeping you from being more like Jesus. You don't fix it. You take it to the cross and you say, Lord, raise me up on the other side of that cross to be more like you and to let that thing go. So when I was saying first you know and then you go, and then you grow, the word grow there could make you think you're getting higher up, but really, when you're growing in Christ, you're growing in stature to serve. And that doesn't always feel like going up, even though it is in the kingdom of God. You gain authority when you serve people in that spirit of the Lord. And that's a hard one in America because it's all about competition. And I got an MBA, you know, master's in business administration, and I know all the formulas and the algorithms, and time is money. Well, God is time. So you spend time with God, you'll make more money. Like, that's how that works. What good shall it be to gain the whole world and lose your soul? Somebody smart said that. Who said that? Yeah. What shall it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? It's a rat race. I'm not a rat. I'm not getting in a rat race. I'm a child of God. And so are you. So the best advice we could give you is be more like Jesus, but then we have to show you how to do it. We don't have to do anything, but that's our goal. And hopefully first by living it. When Trisha talks about prayer, she's not telling you somebody else's advice. She's a woman of prayer. And I wasn't as much of a prayer person when we first got married, but I kept seeing the results were amazing. And she was making better decisions than I was. So, hey, you know, don't need a building to fall on my head to realize I'm missing something here. So the grow piece, first you know, right? The Daniel Amstutz. Remember Daniel Amstutz when he was here? Would you like to have him back again? Me too. Love that guy. Amazing story he has. He said, the truth shall set you free. But before that, it says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. And I'm turning my fan back to me now. Come on. Cool under pressure. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. He says, it's only the truth you know that really sets you free. You could take it up with him if you disagree, but it's like forgiveness. If you talk to anybody who works on our counseling team, you know, that's putting in like 20 to 30 hours a week in front of people counseling, they'll say about forgiveness, people will say, but I thought I forgave that person. And what's the answer? If you've been in our ministry, they'll say, you have, but there's another level. See, so it's not accomplished yet. That was the name of the class that we taught, was accomplishing forgiveness. When you're wondering about whether you've forgiven somebody or not, you could think about, what if I haven't seen them in a while, but what if I'm walking down the street and I see them walking the other way on the other side of the street? What would my first reaction be? Duck in behind the door and hope they don't see me. But I've forgiven them, really. Maybe at a level, you haven't put a hit out on him yet. Maybe you would just say, hey, Bob, how you doing? It's a little better. Maybe it would be, hey, what's going on? How you been? And maybe it would be, I was just praying for you this morning, and I'm glad I saw you. Like, 'cause that's the Jesus level. Yeah. Thanks, Jesus. Love my enemies? Yeah. Really? Isn't there a decaf version of Christianity? Can't I just not hate them? You could do whatever you want. If you want to flourish, you keep knowing more truth. Because knowing is different than hearing something in your head. Knowing it is when it's in your muscle. It's built right in. You know the truth. And that's what sets you free. Amen? So I want to stand and pray before I launch here. It's time. So could you stand, please, and let's just pray. Because it's the first day of the year on the calendar and the first hours of the first day. It's a good prophetic symbol for us to say, we want this year to be more like you, Lord. Everything in me wants to be more like you. You gave me your spirit. You gave me the truth of the word. You gave me other Christians around me who love me and know me. And want the best for me. Do you? Do you want the best for your friends? Isn't that one of the things that lets you know that you really love somebody, is you want the best for them. And we want the best for all of you. And the Lord is going to say, how did you take care of the people I sent you? They were my kids. So if you're looking at somebody else at the rec center when we're having fellowship, not today we won't be, but like there was a great crowd there last week. You know, some people might still be a little rough around the edges. But weren't you once? This morning? So, you know, we're not just here to avoid the person. You know, keep your heart open and say, what do you want me to say to them, Lord? In a civil way. Not what my flesh wants to say. So come on, let's just put our hand on our heart, because that's where it starts. Guard your heart, for out of it flows the issues, everything about life. So, Lord, we just say, we're serious about this. We're not just operating in a religious ritual, Lord. We recognize your power in our lives. And the more we lean into you, the more we take on your characteristics and your traits, the better our lives go. Doesn't mean we don't have problems, but you give us everything that we need. And your word says that we are partakers of the divine nature. A miracle happened when that happened. And we want to partake this year more in the divine nature and less in that selfish nature that we were born with. Let that man die, and that you would resurrect spirit, soul, and body in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so now we can launch. God will resurrect my spirit, soul, and body right now. Not just when I die. I will get a new body when I die. Anybody happy about that? Yeah, just like Jesus had a new body when he was resurrected, we are promised a resurrected body. Don't always think about that, but we should. But what about now? Does my spirit need to be resurrected? Say yes. It'll go faster. You might think, no, but I'm talking about the human spirit that's in us. Yes, Holy Spirit dwells in us, but if we don't yield to Holy Spirit, he stays locked in a vault because we still allow our emotions and our spirit to rule our actual behavior, because your beliefs are what drive your behavior. Not the words you say. You really believe something when your actions follow what you're doing. That's what drives it, see? So it's important to know it here first, but it's got to get in the muscle. And the muscle is the way you respond to things. So think about King David, right? He knew it was a sin, but when he walked out onto that deck, he did not flee the way Joseph fled from Potiphar's wife. He lingered. So the Bible says, at the time when kings go to war, David stayed in the palace. So if you don't go to the war, guess what happens? The war comes to you. So he might have known the truth, but his behavior said, I don't believe it because I'm lingering here and looking at a woman bathing right now. So what we say matters, but what we believe is the final result. So we want to keep having deeper levels of knowledge and belief in our lives. And that comes the more you spend time with the Lord. And you know this is true because when you first got saved, you read your Bible maybe for the first time. We were raised in a denomination that told us not to read it because that would confuse us. Boy, was that bad advice. And all of a sudden you're finding all these treasures in here and you know it at a certain level, but then 10 years later you go back and you read the very same thing, but you interpret it differently. Why? Did it change? What changed? You. So no matter how long you've been saved, it's too deep. They're unsearchable riches, is what Paul said about Scripture. So the longer you're with him, the hungrier you are, the more knowledge and belief and translation into your daily life comes. And that's an amazing transformation, isn't it? Talk about a caterpillar going to a butterfly. Wow, that's the sign of the transformation that we actually change. So Philippians in the Amplified says it this way, and this is also the text verse that Isaac uses in the video I told you to watch. It's so rich, I don't have to say really repeat anything he said, because this part of Philippians is just really rich. And I'm choosing to look at it a little bit differently today to help you try to translate it into our daily lives. So in the Amplified version in Philippians 3:11, it says that if possible, I may attain to the spiritual and moral resurrection that lifts me out from among the dead, even while in this body. Right? So when we read it in the New King James or most translations, it just says that I may have fellowship with his sufferings, but also fellowship with his resurrection. See, well, that's great, but it's not just the final resurrection when he comes back, because that's when we're all going to come back alive and rule and reign with him on his final return. When he comes back, we're going to spend eternity with him ruling and reigning. You should be really excited about that. But there's a big question. Well, I wonder what that's going to look like. Well, he didn't tell us much, but he gave us enough hints to be excited about it. Amen? So that's another day's topic. Just here, the language in the Amplified really breaks it down the way I want you to think about it when you're reading Philippians 3, which is one of the memory verse sections you should have as you're devoting yourself to Scripture. It's just so rich. If possible, I may attain to the spiritual and moral resurrection, my character, who I am when nobody's watching, doing it because you know it's the right thing to do, not because, well, maybe I shouldn't do it because I'll get caught. Oh, that happens in the world all the time. If they don't think they're going to get caught, now they have a whole different set of values. No, it should be one set of values, his way. So first you know at the level I've been talking about, then you go. Because in the going is the growing. Yeah, you get it? It's when you go is when you grow. When you just think about it in your room and you're reading it, that's great, but you're not going. But reading it and saying, I'm going to do something with what was given to me. And that's why I like to use the food pantry as an example, because you really don't need to know a lot of scripture to help us hand out food, do you? No, you just have to have a love in your heart towards these people that aren't, obviously if they're there, they need help. And we're not judging them. We're just saying, look, we're here to help. That's what the church is supposed to be, a resource in a region. so that people's lives change. And the Lord just keeps downloading more ideas of more ways that we could help people in this region to us. And he's making a way where there didn't appear to be a way before, because he's happy about it. Guess what? He wants the lives to change in this region too. But if all we do is bunker ourselves in our room and study, 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 but we don't actually go, then we don't grow. Because the growing is in the going. Thank you, Rich. I didn't pay him for that either. So you all know that the word apostle means sent one. Disciple as well, sent one. That's going, isn't it? Go ye therefore into all. That was the Great Commission. Go. So Paul, man, he was Saul, then he's Paul, and he gets this assignment from the Lord. This is what it looked like. The book of Philippians, right, that we just read from, that's, see how that yellow arrow's coming in? Yes? Okay, it's all the way up at the top. Jerusalem's all the way down at the bottom right-hand corner. And this is a long way from home, from Jerusalem. But that's where this book was written, or the people he was writing this book to, is how I should have said it. And that's just one part of a big journey that he went on. You could see the black lines. That makes like a big rectangle almost where he was going. And this particular city of Philippi was a very developed city. It was like the capital city of that region. And you can find these pictures online that show this 5,000-seat amphitheater that they had built. It was at the height of the Greek culture. It was built in 400 BC, so four centuries before Christ. And I don't know how well you could see that picture, but that's the jail they think he was in Acts chapter 16, I believe it is, right? So this is not like, you know, real Taj Mahal. This is rough. This is a rough place to get put in jail. And I just want to unpack it a little bit, because I really believe that idea that first we know, we get some level of knowledge, and then we go, and in the going is the growing. And that's exactly what Paul did. But he waited, right? So one day in Acts chapter 13, as these men were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, appoint Barnabas and Saul for the special work to which I have called them. And you see up at the top, it says, sent ones, called, anointed, and appointed. Anybody remember the book? That was the title of the book, Called, Anointed, and Appointed, right? So I don't want to steal it. What was her? Jenny Grine, I think her name was? Jenny Grine. Thank you, Terry. Appreciate that. So let's say it together. Called, anointed, and appointed. You get a calling, and somebody lays hands on you and anoints you to go, and then, boom, you get appointed to different assignments along the way, even though you don't know what they look like. And one of my favorite verses to quote, as you may know, is Hebrews 11:8. It says, Abraham went not knowing where he was going. Sounds like F Troop, doesn't it? Remember that? Where the heck are we? And that was the name of the tribe, the Hekawi tribe. Where the heck are we? Right? Where the heck are we? I'm going, but I don't know where I'm going. Like, so then you don't really know where you're going. No, I do, because I'm listening to the Lord. He said, go. And as I go, he'll show me. Called, anointed, and appointed. So this is the point in Acts 13 where it says, appoint Barnabas and Saul for the special work for which I have called them. So after more fasting and prayer, key theme today, fasting and prayer, key theme. You're going to hear it over and over again. After more fasting and prayer, the men laid hands on them and sent them out on their way. So Barnabas and Saul were sent out by who? That's a key truth right there too, right? It's men that were laying hands on them, but it was the Holy Spirit that prompted all of that work. So I don't think there's too much emphasis you could put on Holy Spirit when it comes to learning how to yield to him in your life already. He's got to be in there, because you couldn't have said yes to Jesus without him. But the level that we yield to his authority in our lives, Tricia mentioned authority, this is really important. The truth of the word, but also the prompting of the Holy Spirit is going to be crucial in everything I'm reading to you. So then we go back to Acts chapter 9, and you remember Ananias, right? Anybody remember Ananias? I called it the dangerous yes, because God rings him up. Talk about a calling, right? God calls up Ananias in prayer and says, hey, got to pay attention. I got an assignment for you. Yeah. All right, I'll read it. Arise, go to the street which is called Straight, and inquire of the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he is praying. Told you it would come up again. Why was he praying? Anybody remember the story? Because he was blind. So he's praying that his eyes would be opened again, right? He got in a big mess of trouble, kicking against the pricks of God. Remember that? And I can't go off that tangent, but yeah, he's seen a vision of a man named Ananias. That would be you, Ananias. I told him you were going to be coming before I even asked you, because I knew you'd say yes. Maybe not. I don't know, God. Have you heard about this guy? Like, what? He wants to kill the Christians. I think you got the wrong Ananias here. He's seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming and putting his hand on him that he might receive his sight. And you got to be wondering, Ananias is going, really? Like, what? I thought I was having a bad day, but this is ruining my day. I don't want to go anywhere near that guy. He's persecuting Christians. But he does go. The Lord said to him, go thy way, on your way to him, for he is a chosen vessel unto me. And I believe each of us could look at the person next to us and say, you are a chosen vessel under the Lord. Do you believe it? How many believe it? All right, if you see somebody without their hand up, lay hands on them and pray. Now, we don't force you to believe anything here. A lot of people don't believe that they're chosen vessels because all they can think about is the mistakes they've made and why would God do that. But God doesn't have the same economy that we have. He doesn't care about ability as much as availability. And your availability is to say, I don't fully understand it, Lord, but I'm willing. Here am I, send me. That's what Isaiah said, right? Wow, a chosen vessel of mine. This guy Paul, who's been killing Christians, is actually a chosen vessel of mine to do what? Bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. Talk about a turnaround. This guy's really going to turn around. So what happens? Now back in Acts chapter 16, it says, when they had gone throughout Phrygia, see the yellow arrow down the bottom? Say yes or I'm not going to go. All right, good. When they had gone throughout Phrygia and the region of Galatia, see that one? Okay. And they were forbidden of the Holy Spirit to preach in Asia. Where's Asia? Wait a minute. That's not where Asia is. Yeah, it is. In this context, you can look this up. It wasn't all the way going to China. It was what they called their terminology at that time is where they thought they were going to go. But what happened? They were forbidden by the Holy Spirit. Wow. He put a big red X up there. How many of you ever felt like you've been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to do something? You can raise your hand. It's okay. Yeah. This is what we should all be saying on a pretty regular basis, because if we're praying and we're asking, he's going to give us advice. But this is like another level of loving us. Something stopped them from going. They had a check in their spirit. This is what the prophetic people say. I have a check in my spirit. Well, what do you mean? I don't know what I mean. I'm just telling you, I have a check. Well, I need more than that. No, you don't. Don't do it. Or go ahead and do it. I'm just not telling you it's a good idea. Put that on a spreadsheet. Doesn't go on a spreadsheet, Dick, right? No. So after they were come to Mysia, oh, wait, you got Asia and now Mysia. See where that is? Thank you. So instead of going where they thought they were going to go, they go to Mysia and they essayed, this is the King James, I like the King James, they essayed to go to Bithynia. Like, this is our best thinking. We got together and we think that's where God wants us to go. They've already been told once no, that they couldn't, and now, but the Spirit suffered them not. Isn't that good? King James English. Suffered them not. I don't think so. Not a good idea. It might be a good idea, but it's not a God idea. I wish I heard that sooner. Would have saved myself a whole lot of trouble. And then going back through Mysia, they came down to Troas. Now, that's, see where that is, right? It's kind of a small map here, but that's right on the coast. And he didn't tell them where to go yet from here, but it's a lot closer to Philippi. I can just give you that little hint. That's where he wants them to go. He has a purpose for them to go to Philippi. And you could say, well, why did he just tell them to go to Philippi? Don't you get that way sometimes? Why are you making this so hard, God? Because you're trying to follow a bunch of rules. That's what you came out of. That's the legalism you came out of. You think following a bunch of rules is going to do it. I'm way too big and dynamic for you to ever be able to fit me in a box. You've got to keep your ear open all the time. Even when you dream, I'm speaking to you. This is a hard truth for a lot of people. Because they think prayer is just putting a list of things together and going and begging God. No, it's a loving father having an open dialogue with you all day, every day, even while you're sleeping, if you're listening. And this says, Psalm 119, verse 105, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Now, we think that means just reading the Bible, not if you're prophetic, because a word from the Lord is the same thing as the word, as long as what you're hearing is from God. Because, you know, your flesh could get in the way. When David went out on that balcony and he sees the naked woman there, whoop, see ya. Nope. Something happened in his brain to stay and linger. And look, he knew better. He wrote so many psalms. He had so many different things he did that would make him a hero. But that one area took him down. Took the whole country down. His son inherited that problem. So the wind reaped the whirlwind. David had, I don't remember, I think it was six wives. He should have had one. Solomon had a whole lot more than him. So reap the whirlwind. Look what it says in Psalm 86. Teach me your way, Lord. So I think that's where the emphasis is. Teach me your way. Because I already know my way. We already figured out how to get this far on our own. But no, I'm changing that now. Teach me your way, Lord, that I might rely on your faithfulness. I love this too. Give me, come on, an undivided heart. An undivided heart. That's what Joseph was reflecting when Potiphar's wife was making a pass at him. Undivided heart. No, I know who I serve, and this is not right. Then I love Deuteronomy 8 too. He says, he humbled you. Anybody been humbled since you've been a Christian? You see somebody with their hand not up, you need to pray for them too, because it's coming. It doesn't take long till you get humbled when you're a Christian. He allowed you to hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know. Remember, first we know, then we go. And in the going is the growing. That he might make you know that man shall not live by bread alone. This is what Jesus was quoting when he says this in the New Testament. Man shall not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that's proceeding, that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord. That includes prophetic words when you trust the source. That's a whole other tricky thing, isn't it? How do I know I could trust them? Look, you know, he's not a mean God. He's not trying to make it harder. He wants you to live with a level of discernment that will allow you to cause people's lives to change for the better and not put them back in the bondage of legalism again. So Philippians 3:12 in the New King James says, I press on. Can you say that out loud? I want to just get you in the habit. I'm pressing on. What are you pressing on for? I'm pressing on to know him at a deeper level. I want to know the truth, and I want the truth that I know to set me free from whatever that next thing is that's trying to hold me back. And there will be something for the rest of our lives. That's not a defeatist attitude. That's just reality. You got born into a sinful world. So there will always be sin crouching at your door wanting to have you. But the more you're in the Lord, the less likely that's going to impact you in a negative way. You're going to get discernment to be able to help other people get out of that sin. So it's not just you, it's others as well. I'm going to lay hold of the thing for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. And some of you remember Mark Hamby that have known us a long time. And he said, it was like God was playing a game of tag. And he came and he tagged you and said, you're it. And then he took off, and now you've been chasing him ever since. I'm trying to lay hold of the thing that you laid hold of me for. What was that thing? That's unfolding all the time. That's unfolding. But the truth is, the more you submit to Holy Spirit over your flesh, the more you submit to the truth of the written word of God, the more you'll flourish. So what are we waiting for? Let's get started. So now I'm back on the map again. Troas would have been on the right, and this is Philippi. So that yellow arrow now you see is Philippi. A vision appeared to Paul in the night while they were in Troas, and a man of Macedonia stood and pleaded with him, saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. There's that dream, see? Even when you're not awake, God's speaking to you. It says a vision appeared to him in the night. Maybe he wasn't sleeping, it's possible. But are you alert when he's talking? Keep your lamps, come on, trimmed and burning. Don't be going off to get oil. You got the oil. Keep your lamps trimmed and burning. Be waiting for him. Come to Macedonia and help us. Now, after he had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go to Macedonia, because that's sure a whole lot better than Bithynia, because the Holy Spirit stopped us. But now God is telling us where he wants us to go, because he knows it was a dream from God, concluding that the Lord had called us to preach the gospel to the Macedonians. I'm just going to spend a little time here, because when you plant a church like we did, you go through a lot of ups and downs, right? There's so many unpredictable things. And I said, like in the beginning, I had the I don't know spirit. People would ask me questions and I'd say, I don't know. I don't know. Where are you going to meet? When are you going to start meeting on Sundays? I don't know. How long are you going to keep working? I don't know. Well, what do you know? I know I married a prophet and God told us to come out here and start a church. And I know how to play the guitar. Yeah, that might help someday. So they sail and they go from Neapolis, which is right near Philippi, across that Aegean Sea. And from there to Philippi, which is the foremost city of that part of Macedonia, a colony. This is Luke writing, because we're in the book of Acts, and Luke is a brilliant writer. You should just give him a lot of credit. In fact, he wrote more verses between the Gospel of Luke and the book of Acts than Paul did in all of Paul's writings. So Luke should have a high standing, and he wasn't Jewish. He was a physician, smart guy. And I'm grateful for Luke. We were staying in that city for some days, and on the Sabbath day, we went out of the city of Philippi to the riverside where the prayer was customarily made. I'm going to go a little faster now because it's a narrative. And we sat down and spoke to the women who were there. And you're thinking as you're talking to each other, like, hey, this is going pretty well. We got to Philippi. Now there's a prayer group. And we start talking to these women in the prayer group. And a certain woman named Lydia heard of us. She was a seller of purple from the city of Thyatira who worshiped God. And the Lord opened her heart to the things that we were saying, spoken by Paul. And when she and her household were baptized. So somebody heard the good news and got saved. And this is woman Lydia and her household. And then she begged them, if you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come to my house and stay. And I'm sure they prayed. And this lady persuaded them to go. Now it happened as we went to prayer that a certain slave girl possessed with a spirit of divination met us. Now if we just go back to that map for a minute, when you cross over into that new territory, there's a whole new set of spirits dealing with that region. Right, you're used to being in a city where there's a lot of maybe the Judeo-Christian belief from the Jewish doctrine at least, but now you're in a whole different ballgame now. This girl, it says, right, it happened in verse 15, as we went to prayer, she followed, a spirit of divination met us. A girl possessed with a spirit of divination. Aren't you glad that doesn't happen anymore? I got you, Nate, one of the few times I got you. Yeah, the devil hasn't lost any of his tools. So why would God take away Holy Spirit from you? He loves you. He's not taking it away. And she made her masters much profit by fortune telling. She followed Paul and cried out, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God who proclaim to us the way of salvation. Well, on a certain level, that's true because they had just been called, anointed, and appointed to do this work. So is she tuned into the right channel? No. She's getting from the dark side. And Paul might say, like Nehemiah, if you look at the book of Nehemiah, when he goes to Jerusalem, he doesn't tell anybody he's there. He's on a reconnaissance mission. And this girl's blowing their cover. And I'll decide when I tell people who we are, not you, spirit. He recognized it right away, didn't he? And this she did for several days while Paul, greatly annoyed, the spirit of slap was all over Paul. He turned and said to the spirit, I command you in the name of Jesus to come out of her, and he. I thought it was a she. Well, she had a he. Spirit in her. All the people in the ministry, like, I heard that before. I heard a man's voice come out of a woman. Because the devil's a crook. He tries to steal people's identity. He's always looking for a place to land. But we're going to say, nope, Spirit of God has residence here. No room for you at this inn, devil. When our master saw that their hope of profit was gone, they were like, oh, it's so good. At least she doesn't have a devil anymore. No, the devil in them started speaking, and they dragged him into the marketplace to all the authorities. In verse 23, I jumped ahead. When they had laid many stripes on them, they threw them into prison, commanding. You saw that picture of that prison, right? And this is not the Hilton. Commanding the jailer to keep them securely. Having received such a charge, the jailer put them in the inner prison and fastened their feet in the stocks. But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake. So the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened. Not just Paul's cell, all the doors were open, and all the chains came off. And the keeper of the prison, the jailer, awakened from sleep and seeing the prison doors open, supposing the prisoners had fled, drew his sword and was about to kill himself. Because that's my relatives, the Romans, were about to take him out. He figured, I might as well take myself before they get here. Because if the prisoners go, I'm cooked. Stick a fork in it. But Paul called with a loud voice and said, do yourself no harm, for we are all here. Why would they all be there? If the chains broke and the prison doors are open, why wouldn't the criminals just take off? Ever wonder about that? I think the anointing was so strong of the presence of God, it's like they couldn't move. There's another reason that I'll get to. Then he called for a light. This is the jailer. He ran in and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas, and he brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? How do I get out of this mess? Because the Romans are going to find out and they're going to kill me. And whatever you got has more power than what I got, so what do I do to get what you have? Boy, wouldn't that be a good witness if we were doing that? And people get saved just by being around you, and they see the demonstration of the power. Paul said, I didn't come with flashy language, eloquent words. I came with a demonstration of the power. And we'll do it today at the end of the service. We'll be praying for people and believing God for miracles. Every time we meet, we want to do that, right? Because why would God pick and choose? Peter said that you're not respecting one person more than another. You love us all the same. It's us, like Trisha said, you got to look in the mirror sometimes and say, I love you, even though you know all the terrible things you've done more than anybody else does. And it's hard, isn't it? It's hard to forgive yourself. But another day. So Paul gives a pretty quick answer. What must you do to be saved? Okay, well, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you will be saved, and your household. How many have stood on that for your family? Acts 16:31. And they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house, and he took them the same hour that night and washed their stripes. So he goes from being the jailer to inviting them to his home, and he washes out their stripes. I'll plant this little seed and you decide whether you think it's legit or not. What if when Paul was in Troas and that dream happened and there was a man calling out to him, come and help us? What if it was the jailer? What if it was the jailer praying, like, I don't want to work for these Romans. God, you got to help us. If you're real, would you send somebody here to tell me? We don't know. That could have been him. Whatever. Like I said, you can dig in and figure that out. But who is God hearing and wanting you to go talk to? Where he's stopping you from doing this and he's stopping you from doing that. Well, but this one's working, and boom, a dream comes in. And this is how we're supposed to live every day. This is the life of a Christian. Not boring. Not caught up in all the things that the world is offering us, which are just chewing gum. It tastes good, but there's no nutrition. Right? I mean, you die. If all you had was gum on a desert island, you'd be dead. Tastes good, though. Immediately, he and all his family were baptized. Now you got Lydia's family and this, and now you got a church starting in Philippi because somebody said yes to that dangerous question. Will you go for me? Called, anointed, and appointed. I know it, I'm going, and now I'm growing. That's how it works. Somebody clapped. So this gives you a whole different light, and I'm winding down now. To all the saints in Christ Jesus who are in Philippi, with the bishops and the deacons. So this church grew, right? Because they didn't just have that house church anymore. There was a whole bigger church, enough to have bishops and deacons. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, making requests for you all with joy for your fellowship. And I can imagine Paul saying, I can still remember the face when that jailer walked in. I can still remember him saying, what must I do to be saved? Like, every time I think of you, I remember the early days of that church being planted. Because somebody was willing to go without instructions. Called, anointed, and appointed. And you go, and God will show you. It takes a lot of faith, doesn't it? In every prayer, by making requests for you, for your fellowship in the gospel, from the first day until now. From when we cast out that demon out of that girl, and they threw us in jail, and then you washed our stripes out, and that church got started. From the first day that we went over into that new area where the gospel had never been, didn't take long to bump into some spirits. But you stay true to the God that you serve, those spirits flee. Yeah, I mean, they did. They got persecuted. Guess what? People don't like you messing with their devils. You know, if you've been in addiction, they say there's a monkey on your back. So don't feed the monkey. Starve the monkey. So if we're in a culture that's full of people that walking around with all crazy ideas, don't coddle that. Tell them the truth. They want to hear it. You know, it doesn't look like they do, but they do. They want to hear the truth. We don't have to go far to find the truth. Then he says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. I know people have a little problem with this. We're not trying to get saved. We don't work to get saved. It's now that you've been saved, how do you know and go and grow? That's the best way I could say it to you. He doesn't want you to just sit and stay at one level. You should never plateau as a Christian. You should always be getting greater and greater, more like Christ. And I'll be honest, he expects us to do that. So there's a higher level of expectation, in my opinion. I could defend this. The longer you're saved, the higher the bar gets, because that's how you would say to your children, right? You're not four anymore. You're 14. There's a big difference. And I have a right to expect that in you because I love you. Don't be staying on the pacifier. Isaac Peter calls it, this is grown folk business. Ain't no pablum. We're having some filet. That's as far as I'm going to go to try to imitate him, I promise. He says, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do. Woo! To will and to do. I know what God's will is, but what about the doing? I know the willing, but are you willing to doing? Do all things without complaining and disputing. Can I repeat that? Do all things without complaining and disputing. Do all things without complaining. We're good. We're good, aren't we? We're good at complaining and disputing. That you may become blameless and harmless, children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. Is this a crooked and perverse generation that we're living in right now? It's so perverse, there is no such thing as perverse. You made that up. Everything's okay. No. Sorry. No. Wake up. Snap out of it. Among whom you shine as lights in the world. See? We're talking about this all the way back in Philippians. When you're not in that perverse generation, when you're doing what Jesus told you to do, living together in community, there's an attraction that people want to come and be with you because they don't have it. So the darker it gets out there, the easier it should be to grow the church. If what we have is legit, then what we have is legit. It's true. They should be coming. But what things were gained to me, these I've counted loss for Christ. Yet indeed I also count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ. So he used to think the more I studied, the higher up in the hierarchy of the Jewish leadership I got, that was the most valuable thing. No, because that's knowing this, but didn't translate into the behavior. He was killing the Christians. That'll preach. for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish. All of that prestige that I had studying under Gamaliel means nothing. Here's what I want. I want to gain Christ and be found in him. How about you? I want to gain Christ and be found in him. Jesus said, when I come back, will I find faith in the earth? Only you can answer that question. I want to gain Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is what he came out of, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God. Come on. The just shall live. There's the Reformation right there. The just shall live by faith. I knew what it was like to try to earn my way in God's ladder system, but this isn't about that. This is about faith. The just shall live by faith. It can only be about what you believe, not what you have to do to earn it. That I may know him. There it is again. Knowledge is only a rumor until it lives in your muscles. That's not my line, but it really makes sense. It's the doing that makes it real. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection. That's where we started, right? And the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. Now, hopefully, what I just told you helps you see it's not just about when this life is over that you're going to be resurrected. It's about every Monday through Friday, Saturday, Sunday. It's all the time that I may know him, put the things to death that need to die, so I'm resurrected, and on the other side of that crucifixion, I'm more like Christ. Not up here. Woo! Nobody likes that foot washing sermon, I can tell you that. I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already attained or am already perfected, but I press on. Can you guys stand up? Let's just stand. This is the time to press on. I want to press on in 2023. I was telling somebody the other day, our pastor in the church we were in 1999, he spent the whole year, every midweek service, talking about Y2K. And was completely wrong. Right? He was doing the best he could. What can I tell you? Here we are in 2023. Wow. Who knew? I think that the longer you're in the Lord, the stronger you get. It's amazing how this all works. So we're going to press on. How about you? I press on that I may lay hold of that which Christ tagged me and said, you're it. Now come and chase me. That he laid hold of me. I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I'm going to do. Thank you, Nate. Forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call in Christ. Every time I let something go down here, there's less of me to have to deal with. But I'm not floating off into a cloud with a harp. I'm getting down and getting my hands dirty to help somebody. A million ways you could do that. Now, I'll tell you, you ever see this word nevertheless in the Bible? I mean, something's coming. Something's coming, right? Like, it's like, therefore. Whenever you see therefore, you got to find out what it's. You've been to Sunday school. And it's funny how long you can be saved and just something pops out like you haven't ever seen it before, right? Nevertheless, to the degree that we have already attained. That's so key. Stop comparing yourself to the big hero, Heidi Baker, let's just say. You know, she's a wonderful lady, but I'm not her. But why would we do that? That's an American thing, to compare yourself to everybody else. Well, I haven't written a book, and I haven't. God didn't care about that. You be you. Maybe you'll write a book, maybe you won't, but you don't want to become a clone of somebody else. You're fearfully and wonderfully made. And all of us are responsible to help each other reach this place of convergence. That's Lance Wallnau. That's our friend. That's what he calls it. It's a brilliant way to think about it. It's Trisha Festa growing up in Paterson, New Jersey, with her two sisters who are here. And having a really rough life, but God knowing that there was a different direction than what the natural realm would have said, and her tenaciously, when I tell you, there should be a picture in the dictionary next to tenacious of Trisha. Devil, you're not stopping me. I'm pressing towards the prize, and I know the prize that he has for me. Get out of my way. We need that. We need fire. Don't settle for less. And look, none of us have arrived, but to the degree that you've already attained. Anybody attained something in the Lord? You know the Bible? You know John 3:16? God so loved the world? That's better than it was. I used to listen to a record called Friend of the Devil. So John 3:16, better than that. I don't want to do drugs anymore. When I first got saved, I had so much more money in my wallet. I'm like, what happened? Well, you're not buying rounds for the whole bar anymore. Because you don't get drunk, knucklehead. Now I have more money to give at church. No more Jack. Man, thank you, Lord. What a mess. What a mess. Every one of you has attained to some degree of knowledge of God, but there's no limit to how far you can go in knowing him. And that's a great goal for this year. That's what I'm going to leave you with. To the degree that we've already attained, let us walk in that same rule and let us be of the same mind, for our citizenship is in heaven. We're walking this earth sojourners. That's King James too, right? We're just sojourners here, but we're about the Father's business. And my food is to do the will of the one who sent me. That's what Jesus said. So as you're doing the Father's will, you'll be nourished. You'll grow. When you get tempted out on that rooftop, nope, I'm going back. Keep the coat. Whatever her name was, Potiphar's wife. You know, if I was Joseph, she'd have been the first appointment in my office when I got put in charge. So it's a good thing you're not God. Man, our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly wait for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Come on. Who will transform our lowly body that it may be conformed to his glorious body. Could you lift your hands? Let's just pray. Father, I thank you for everybody who's here today, that we would set this time aside for you each week and midweek and during the week, that we would just spend time digging into your word and getting to know you and opening our heart to Holy Spirit to say, we want you to be well pleased when we see you, Lord. We want to hear you say, well done. It's not a works mentality. It's a love mentality. Because we love you and we want to please you. Because we're so grateful for what you've done for us. Lord, I thank you for your tribe at King of Kings. And anyone who's watching right now, Lord, I thank you that this is your plan for them. To be more like you every day. To know the truth. And then to go into the world and tell people about it so that they can grow into more of you. Because it's through the doing. It's as we are participating in that gift is when we get those muscles. So I bless your people as they're going to go today to celebrate with their families and anybody who's in town, and to enjoy their day off tomorrow, and just to meditate like we sing on the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All our lives you have been good to us, and we are here for a reason, and we are going to take territory back from the enemy in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask the prayer ministry team to come up right now. That could be for those of you that need prayer. But I also just want to say, if you don't know the Lord, this could be a really important moment in time for you. Maybe you're waiting. I've waited. I heard an altar call many times, and I just waited. But eventually, my heart was ready. And when I was in that kitchen 40 years ago this morning, I ended up saying yes. So can we just pray, church? There might be somebody here, there might be somebody watching online that hasn't known Jesus in a personal relationship. How many here know Jesus in a personal relationship? Did you even think that was possible before you were saved? So if you don't know that, we just want to pray. We'll just say a prayer out loud together, and you can invite the Lord into your heart. It might sound too easy. It's not. You have to make a decision in your heart that you want to serve him. That's not easy. But make the decision. Don't you agree, church? Best decision you could ever make. Let's pray out loud. Heavenly Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus Christ. I heard good news today that my life can change and be more like you. But I have to invite you in first. It's got to be my decision, because you're not going to force your way in. But I lift my hand right now and make that decision to accept you into my heart as my Lord and Savior. I've got a lot of questions, but I believe you have a lot of answers. And I want to give you a try, because my life isn't where it should be. Please forgive me, Lord, for running away from you. And accept me now as I run to you as your son, adopted child, daughter, child of God. In Jesus' name, amen.